This episode of Musical Hell is brought to you by Midnight Musicals. Welcome to the podcast Musical Underground. Thank you. Greetings, mortals. Welcome to another session of the Infernal Court in Musical Hell. I'm Diva, your judge, jury, executioner, and sweet Lucifer, how many musical versions of Cinderella do we need? The answer is 2. Disney and Rodgers and Hammerstein, 2 1/4 if we're counting Into the Woods. Everyone else can just sit down. I am looking in your direction, Andrew Lloyd Webber, and I am especially looking in your direction, Next Defender, the 2021 film adaptation. I mean, I get why people keep coming back to Cinderella. It's probably the most famous version of an archetype that goes at least as far back as the opposition's kid. There's a certain charm to the karmic simplicity of the story. Kindness and patience in adversity are rewarded, while selfishness and cruelty don't pay. And because of that simplicity, lots of people have adapted it to reflect their times, culture, and/or values. But this time, despite the inspired casting of Billy Porter and Idina Menzel, the results... well, let's just say the pandemic-enforced shutdown should have been taken as a warning sign. Alas, it was not. And so we are left to examine the case of Cinderella 2021. Porter leads us in with some opening narration, explaining that once upon a time there was an old-fashioned kingdom ruled by tradition.
Tradition! Tradition!
Unfortunately, we're not that lucky when it comes to an opening number. Instead, we get this.
People of the world today are looking for a better way.
Let's talk about how the songs are used and why it's sin number one. In my long, long years sitting in judgment in this court, I have come to somewhat revise my opinion on jukebox musicals. The problem isn't a question of taking existing songs and trying to work them into a narrative, but neglecting to do so in an interesting or inventive manner. The better jukebox musicals will put creative spins into the score. And Juliet is a good recent example, transforming the dance pop of Baby One More Time into a determined survival anthem, or switching up the contexts of I'm Not a Girl, Not Yet a Woman, and I Kissed a Girl by having them refer to a gender-fluid character. This movie isn't that clever. In fact, this movie is more on the level of those politicians who choose Born in the USA for their rallies because they like the way the hook sounds. That's the only reason I can think of for choosing a protest anthem like Rhythm Nation for your village of social norm conformists, or having the prince face a dance floor full of wannabe princesses with Seven Nation Army. Even the songs that do fit feel kind of off at times. Our title character is introduced singing You Gotta Be, but instead of leaning into its confident resolve, Camila Cabello plays it more like Happy Working Song.
You gotta be cool, you gotta be calm, gotta keep it together. All I know, love will save the day.
During the opening song, we're introduced to Cinder Girl Ella, her stepmother Vivian, and Vivian's daughters Malvolia and Nerissa. The household dynamics are par for the Cinderella course.
Unhappy with the tea, stepmother? Imagine if you served such swill to your future husband. How long would it take for him to abandon you?
Vivian is quite adamant that the ladies in her charge marry well, even if it means accepting the attentions of creepy neighbor Thomas, who, as far as creepy neighbors in Cinderella stories go, isn't anywhere near Richard O'Brien's level. But Ella, shockingly, isn't interested in marriage and wants to design dresses and own her own business and be her own woman, because everyone say it with me, she's not like other Cinderellas. While the concept of Cinderella as a passive cipher waiting for a prince to come around and lift her up out of the ashes is something of an oversimplification, getting her story to work for a post-1950s audience does require some fleshing out. Most adaptations in the past decades have given her an update, and perhaps the most frustrating thing about this version is that it doesn't seem aware of that fact. It presents itself as a hip, relevant twist on the dusty old fairy tale, but the truth is, everything it does, giving the title character more developed motivations and interests, having her meet the prince early on but not knowing he's the prince until later, more sympathetic aspects to the stepfamily, and so on, have been done before and much better by other versions. The pseudo-feminist spin amounts to a thin veneer of not like other girls posturing, where it's assumed that the only way to be a strong woman is to avoid any implication of traditionally feminine interests and roles. Take Princess Gwen, the younger child of the royal family who advocates tirelessly to uplift the voices of women. Well, one woman anyway.
Don't even think about it, Gwen.
You're literally not even going to let me have a seat at the table.
The problem with this token attempt at girl power is the more you think about it, the more it falls apart. If Ella is so ambitious, what, apart from generally sexist strawman opposition, keeps her serving tea for her stepfamily? Why do all her attempts at empowering dialogue sound like they were lifted from a Dove soap commercial? What makes Vivian perpetuate an unjust system she's also suffered from? And is Gwen's revolution really that admirable considering it's focused entirely on her own position and ignores the other women around her like her mother and the castle servants? A better movie wouldn't necessarily need to answer these questions, but it would know that they exist. So while Ella has her girl boss dreams to the tune of what sounds like a Pasek and Paul Trunk song, let's meet her theoretically charming prince, here called Robert. As with most princes since the Disney Golden Age, he's not thrilled with the prospect of marrying someone he barely knows for political reasons. And while his mother, Queen Beatrice, is played by Minnie Driver at her most sensible, his father, King Rowan, is played by Pierce Brosnan at his most aggressively Irish, and he is furious with the situation.
When you marry, you'll settle down.
You'll stop behaving like my idiot son, and the perception of the people will be that you take the crown seriously.
You know how it goes. The king expects his son to marry, he's going to hold a ball to choose a bride, and a random gospel choir in the background adds interjections that aren't as funny as the movie thinks. Okay, the last part might be new. But hey, they had to give the choir something to do while waiting around for Robert to start power ballading his way all over Freddie Mercury's grave.
If I work hard, every day of my life, I try and I try and I try, but...
Did the lighting budget run out for this shot, or did Sony just not want to pay union wages for the crew? Sin number three. It's bad enough that the song choices in this movie range from uninspired to inexplicable, but the way they're filmed is aggravating. Cuts have no rhythm, dance shots are angled and framed in a terribly awkward fashion, and there's so much backlighting and lens flare that J.J. Abrams would get a headache. Possibly the worst example comes when Vivian lectures her daughters on the importance of marrying rich with a rendition of Material Girl. This is a great song for Idina Menzel's rich, brassy belt, and she is slaying it like Van Helsing. But it's hard to enjoy the performance with the hazy sunlight and obstructive laundry, and a cute farm boy who literally never appears before or after this, but still gets to sing backup and do flips for the camera.
'Cause everybody's living in a material world, and I am a material girl.
'Cause we are living.
Seriously, even Tom Hooper was able to get out of the way long enough for his cast to do what they do best. Robert continues his soulful crooning through the changing of the guard, where Ella causes a bit of a scene when she climbs on his grandfather's statue to get a closer look and proves that, on the girl matrix, she's sitting right at the intersection of Not Like Other and Manic Pixie Dream.
It's just really hard to see in the back. Might I suggest you put some bleachers back there? Give us short peasants a chance?
I hereby decree all short peasants shall be pardoned by the king.
Deciding that marrying some random peasant he hardly knows is a better chance at happiness than marrying some princess he hardly knows, Robert agrees to go along with his dad's bride market ball on the condition that all women, regardless of status, be invited. Rowan isn't thrilled with the idea, but his toxic masculinity overrules his class snobbery and he agrees. So Robert disguises himself to go search for his new crush, while his friend slash manservant slash bargain basement Alan Cumming Wilbur looks on.
I do not have a single bat in my belfry.
No, there are multiple bats in your belfry.
I am the prince, and I say that your belfry is the one with the bats.
Well,
though if this is how he acts to his friends, I'm not so sure he's going to make the best first impression on Ella. For a romantic lead, Robert doesn't really exhibit much personality, and the personality he does exhibit is less charming and more swipe left. Robert finds Ella in the market as she attempts to sell one of her dresses, while all the other reindeer laugh and call her names. He tries to mansplain competitive pricing to her and gets an earful of feminism for beginners as a result.
Us ladies give birth. We run households. Surely we can run a business. Can't be that hard.
Robert offers to buy Ella's dress for 3 times her asking price, more out of an attempt to appeal to her than in agreement of what she is saying. As they complete the transaction, the town crier comes out to rap some exposition. Yes, the town crier raps all his announcements because this movie tries to be cool in all the stupidest and most obvious ways.
That's why all the single ladies should be getting excited because every single one to the pool is invited to take a bath, do your hair, buy a fancy new dress, paint your nails, you got a prince to impress. Yeah.
Ella, being not like other Cinderellas, considers the whole idea ridiculous and proof that the prince is a useless idiot. I mean, she's not far off the mark there. But Robert convinces her to see it as a networking opportunity and offers to introduce her to representatives from more liberal kingdoms who might look favorably on her talents. So Ella uses her newfound profits to get materials for a ball gown and starts up an inept music video for a time-passing montage.
That's just how I feel. That's just how I feel. That's just how I feel.
The day of the ball arrives, and once again, Vivian's ambitions for her daughters stop just short of getting them flattering dresses and hairstyles. Ella is ready to go too, but Vivian explains that vaguely creepy Thomas has asked for Ella's hand, and thus she is no longer an eligible maiden, throwing ink on Ella's dress for extra nasty points. So Ella goes into the courtyard to sing her heart out, but all is not lost, for way back in the opening number, she rescued a caterpillar from a spider's web, which has become a symbolic chrysalis which turns all magic and glowy, and voila, homegrown fairy godparent!
Now this is how you make an entrance!
Fab G, as he's styling himself, is grateful for being spared from becoming a spider's dinner and offers to return the favor by getting Ella to the ball.
Do you want to go to that ball and meet a bunch of rich people who will change your life?
Yes, I was just crying and singing about it like 2 minutes ago.
Look, unless your story specifically involves a clash between musical and non-musical universes, you can't just fall back on, hey, we're singing, weird, huh, for your meta-humor. Not only is it overused, it just proves that your understanding of the genre is surface level at best. Look at Schmigadoon. Yes, you have the whole what's with the singing moments, again, because the main characters are outsiders in a musical world, but it expands from there into playing with tropes and archetypes specific to a particular subset of musical, that of the 1940s and 50s golden age. This is a parody made by people who love musicals and know what makes them work, as opposed to people who are too self-conscious about doing a musical to pull it off. With a lot of CGI sparkles and a performance this movie doesn't deserve, Fab G gets down to business. Ella's really not feeling the pantsuit, so he works with a sample from her vision board.
What you can truly be.
And it's kind of a letdown, honestly. Ella's not going to get very far in the fashion world if she can't design herself a more flattering skirt and a better-fitting bodice. The requisite glass slippers, enchanted for easy movement, complete the look, and we move on to transportation. A logo on a shop crate stands in for the pumpkin, and a few CGI mice who have been offering side commentary throughout the movie are pressed into service as footmen.
Whoa! Where's my tail? I can't balance without my tail!
James. Do you mind if I call you James? Do you know why people don't like you? I mean, obviously because you're a rude, entitled asshole with a habit of treating people like absolute shit, but we're focusing on performance choices for now. You have a tendency to take roles that don't work to your advantage. You're more suited for the comic foil, the everyman who sets up the punchline or who deals with the absurdity that surrounds him. There's no shame in this. A good straight man is the foundational aspect of a lot of humor. but you apparently decided you don't want to be the straight man. You want to be the wacky guy who gets the pratfalls and literally stops traffic with his antics. And it's not working for you. There is a certain knack to playing zany without becoming forced or insufferably annoying. Robin Williams had it, Steve Martin has it, and you, James Corden, most certainly do not have it.
I just relieved myself, and you are not going to believe how it happens.
Through the front tail, we know.
Yes! Unbelievable, isn't it? Incredible,
it's right?
Seriously, just stop. You're embarrassing yourself and us. More to the point, you're taking up time that could have been given to Billy Porter because he is barely in this movie and his performance deserves a lot more space. I don't want to say his presence is virtue signaling, because that's the kind of argument you hear from dude bros who think Blazing Saddle's biggest contribution to comedy was its liberal use of the N-word, but it does feel like the writers started with Black Queer Fairy Godmother and didn't put any thought into the character beyond that. Fab G gives some last-minute magic exposition. Ella's relatives will be unable to recognize her, but the stranger she hopes to meet at the ball will, midnight deadline, yada yada, and sends her on her way to the palace, where Rowan is both literally and figuratively lording it over everything.
You know how much I love to dance.
Tonight is not about you, it's about me. And keeping an eye on our son.
I don't like most of the characters in this movie, but Rowan is by far the worst of the lot. His dialogue sounds like it was written for a bumbling sitcom dad type, emotionally stunted and overprotective of his fragile ego, but decent deep down. But Brosnan's performance is cold, aggressively domineering, and callously dismissive of anyone's needs and interests but his own. I don't want to chuckle indulgently at him. I want to give Beatrice the number to a good woman's shelter, or better yet, one of those rings that hides a dose of poison. Robert and his entourage of underdeveloped sidekicks make a grand entrance, and all the single ladies hit the floor to a somewhat decent proto-Bridgerton arrangement. Say what you will about Baz Luhrmann, he knows how to make his rapid-cut, anachronistic style work for him. This movie is more like an Asylum knockoff of his work. Ella puts in an appearance, and her dress impresses visiting Queen Tatiana, who surprisingly isn't put off by Ella's nonsensical babbling.
Beautiful. Me did. It's what I hoped.
Tatiana apparently doesn't have that many royal duties since she usurped the throne in a bloody coup. I'm not even joking, her first line basically admits as much, as she spends most of her time traveling around to other courts and is in the market for a traveling companion and fashion designer. She agrees to meet Ella at 4 the following day, thus setting up the third act conflict, before Ella spies Robert holding court. Realizing she'd been trading banter with the heir to the kingdom, Ella attempts to get the here out of there, but makes the mistake of trying to exit via the orchestra platform. Ella is understandably upset about Robert concealing his true identity, but when he reveals Gwen is sporting Ella's handiwork, it mollifies her enough to hang around for a romantic dance sequence.
Dancing in the dark, with you between my arms.
Ugh, I'm going to need ginger and acupressure bands if they keep this up. Can we go somewhere else?
What? This is bloody brilliant.
Anywhere but this. Better. Robert and Ella are hitting it off until he reveals that he plans to announce her as his chosen bride, and the whole, you can be a princess and live in the palace, and all you have to do is give up the only thing you've ever dreamed about pitch doesn't really sit well with her. But despite it being obvious that Robert doesn't seem to know or care what she wants, she's still conflicted, at least until the hour starts to chime.
What time is it?
It's midnight.
I have to go.
Ella beats tracks, throwing her slipper to ward off pursuers, cause you know, not like other Cinderellas, and manages to leave the castle grounds, but the magic spell is wearing off fast.
No, go past this part. In fact, never play this again.
With the remaining slipper and the mice she mercifully can no longer understand in tow, Ella makes her way back home. Meanwhile, Rowan is pitching a fit at the prospect of Princess running off, and as usual, he's taking it out on his family.
I really think we just need to get some sleep.
No one asked you, Beatrice.
Any ending that does not involve this man and a guillotine cannot be considered happy. Rowan is shocked when his behavior alienates his wife and children, but he doesn't have long to dwell on it as Wilbur comes in with the discarded slipper. Meanwhile, Vivian finds Ella feigning illness in her cellar room and defends her harshness with a bit of backstory.
I was given the opportunity to train at the finest school of music, and I took it. It was just a month, 1 month. And yet when I returned, my husband, well, he believed real wives didn't act so frivolously.
So you see, my life was made miserable by systemic misogyny, so it's only fair for yours to be as well. One of the mice, I'm assuming it's the James Corden mouse since he seems to exist to be awful, dislodges the slipper as Vivian's leaving, revealing Ella as the prince's intended. Vivian is all for Ella marrying upward if it means she and the stepsisters can ride her coattails, but Ella refuses, so Vivian vows to pack her off to vaguely creepy Thomas and offers an original song that deserves a much better movie than this.
Treasure you found, bury it. The only way out, marry it. The shadow of doubt, carry it. Carry it down to your cradle.
Back at the palace, Rowan seeks out Beatrice as he's still perplexed at why she's being so unreasonable about his treatment of her.
You haven't spoken to me since last night. You're mad because I yelled at you.
Come on, it was just a little light verbal abuse. You're taking it entirely too hard. But despite living in vaguely pre-industrial times, Beatrice recognizes gaslighting when she hears it.
You think you're the only person who feels stress?
God, try being your bloody wife. It is utterly exhausting to sit next to you and just smile, as if I were nothing more than a prop.
Somehow, this manages to get a clue into Rowan's thick skull, and he apologizes to Robert, giving him Ella's slipper so he can locate her. The search goes very quickly, mainly because Robert isn't relying entirely on foot size, but yields nothing but disappointment. Meanwhile, Ella is taking her fate into her own hands, or at least the paws of her annoying comic CGI mice. Ella races to her meeting with Queen Titania, crashing into Robert, who gives her a big speech about how she inspired him to choose his own destiny, and he just wants to be with her because she's so damn awesome. They share a quick kiss before he gives her a ride to the market square, but before that plot point wraps up, Beatrice is forced to endure a romantic gesture as well.
Oh no, he's gonna sing.
This is me showing you that I love you like I used to.
No. I mean, props for knowing how to use Pierce Brosnan's lack of talent in this area, but still, no. Rowan does not get to be a callous, bullying, borderline abusive ass for 90% of the movie, then wipe everything away with a comically awkward serenade. Especially since Beatrice is more annoyed by it than anything else, because it shows Rowan has learned nothing. He's still making things all about himself and has no consideration for her needs. This attempt to redeem his character is completely unearned. For that matter, Vivian also gets off pretty light, which is even more annoying because she does have room in her character for a redemption arc, but the movie never develops it, and her making peace with Ella feels more like an afterthought than anything else. Anyway, it all ends happily. Tatiana approves of Ella's portfolio, Robert declares his intention to travel with Ella before settling down, Gwyn gets named official heir, and Rowan tries to wrap everything up quickly, but Beatrice gets her wish of being allowed to contradict him because she wants a dance party ending. After all this time, can anything new be done with Cinderella? Probably. A story that touches on themes of relationships, class and gender roles, identity and transformation will always have room for new interpretations. But the 2021 Cinderella's attempt is half-hearted at best and insulting at worst. It's a shallow attempt at modernization with little skill or style, so the Court of Musical Hell orders the following punishments. For the uninspired and inept use of its jukebox score, the music production team is condemned to have Spotify play nothing but kids' bop covers. For the awkward and uncomfortable filming of the songs, director Kay Cameron is condemned to be eternally stuck in traffic during a James Corden crosswalk musical segment. Speaking of, for his insufferable presence and for producing this mess, James Corden is condemned to alienate everyone around him until he dies alone and unmourned. That's not a sentence, that's just the natural consequence of his actions. So let it be recorded. This session of the Infernal Court in Musical Hell is now adjourned.